Hi, my name is Jose Luis, and welcome to this new video in this series, Introduction to Parametric Modeling. In this video, I would like to teach you a different way of creating geometry, as opposed to the ways we have learned in previous videos in this series, which have been mostly generative ways of creating geometry. So based off planes, points, whatever, we have been constructing more complex forms of geometry. In this one, I would like to take a closer look at another family of operations that we can use that I'm going to refer to as intersections, because what they do is they take perhaps more complex data and they reduce to simpler forms of it by combining them in particular ways of intersections. So this is going to include, for example, intersections between simple elements, or it's going to include what we also refer to in other modeling environments as Boolean operations. So I have a Rhino file that has here a three solids, three boundary representations, a cylinder, a box, and a sphere that I have imported here in Grasshopper. Then I also have two curves that I have brought into Grasshopper and three points that I'm going to use to define a plane in three-dimensional space. I'm going to have the points so that I can move the plane a little bit and play with its orientation. And what I would like to show you is that in Grasshopper, we have a particular tab called Intersection that has a bunch of different categories like mathematical, physical, region, shapes, etc., etc. These are all different kinds of intersection operations that I can do to generate geometry that is derived from the combination of the intersection of two previous elements. So, for example, things that I find quite useful are, for example, if I go to mathematical, you can see that there's a lot of things that I can intersect between each other. So lines with lines with planes, plane with planes with planes with planes, curves with planes, or for example, one of the most common ones, which is intersecting a B-rep with a plane, creating a planar section that we can, that in the form of a curve. So if I plug that in here, the input is the base B-rep, so I'm going to plug in the cylinder, for example, and P is going to be a section plane, which I'm going to use this plane that I have here. And as you can see, the intersection that I get is this circle on the cylinder, which if I now modify a little bit of the orientation of the plane, you can see that that circle, that intersection, which is a curve in 3D space, is just adapting to the orientation of that plane, obviously. Now I can also intersect the box, I can also intersect the sphere, I can intersect basically any B-rep that I want, okay? Other things that are, for example, useful, I think curves and planes are very useful as well. So for example, I can intersect this curve with a plane, that plane that I've been using before, you see? And now, for example, I can just move the plane a little bit up and that is out of the intersection. And those, I'm intersecting in two points. You can see that the intersection of a plane and a curve are actually points, one or more points or none, if they don't really intersect in 3D space. Other kinds of intersections that are typically very useful as well are B-reps with B-reps themselves. So if I go, for example, instead of mathematical, I go to physical, you can see that I have another set of possible combinations between elements, so curves, B-reps, surface and curve, mesh and curve, etc., etc., and even some collisions kind of detections. If I choose B-rep and V-rep, what I can do is I can take two B-rep elements and find the intersection of their shapes. Typically, a general rule of thumb to think about this is that elements that you want to intersect between each of them, typically the result of that intersection is an element that is kind of simpler in terms of geometry. So for example, the intersection of two B-reps is not going to be a B-rep, it's going to be a curve, which is where those B-reps intersect. So in this case, for example, if I want to intersect the cylinder with the box, you can see that what I get here is the contour curve of that intersection. And you can see that here on the output. Or if I intersect the cylinder and the sphere, then I get this really beautiful curve which is the intersection of these elements in 3D space. I'm going to hide this. Then you can see how this is the intersection of these two elements, the curve and the sphere. And if I bake this, you will be able to see how this curve, now I can move it in 3D space, I can get it out of there, and how it has been generated by a collection of control points that it's really, really nice, actually. A very common operation that we typically want to check out as well is what's called Boolean operations. And in other modeling environments, those are typically referred to as union, subtraction or difference, or intersection. What that means is that I can take two solids and then I can compute a third solid that is the union of those two. And the way that works in Grasshopper, for example, is that I can go to shape, and in shape, I can find here, for example, solid difference, solid union, or solid intersection. So if I use, for example, solid union, and I plug in here the cylinder and the sphere with the shift, I add the sphere to this input, and I add also the box if I want, you can see that what I'm getting is this more complex surface that is the pure addition of the three. And if I bake this, you can see that I can now move it around and that this element doesn't have the wall of the cylinder anymore, or it doesn't have the remainder of the box here. And if I explode this, you can see that the explosion generates each one of the surfaces, the original surfaces that form each one of the elements, with the trimming that has happened because of those operations. I can also do, for example, a solid difference where from the cylinder, I can extract, for example, the sphere part. And what that will give me will be a cylinder that has an opening, that has a dent with the shape of the sphere, which is also kind of cool as well. And these operations for union, subtraction, intersection can be done also with curves that are planar. For example, these are typically referred to in Grasshopper as regions. So here we have region difference, region intersection, or region union. So for example, I can take those two curves and do a region union. And you can see that the resulting curve is a curve that is the perimeter of the union of those two. And I can do, for example, a boundary surface to see that a bit more clear. You see that this surface is the union of these two. Or it could be the difference. So for example, I'm going to take from the main curve, I'm going to subtract the second curve, and I'm going to see that the result is now a surface that has that dent, that bite, if you will, inside of it. So these kind of operations can be very useful if I have geometry that is coming from the outside and I need to operate with it, or if I need to do, you know, like some kind of exercise where I do like sections of an element, and that is a very common thing to do, for example, in 3D printing. You basically slice the object with many, many layers so that you can print it one layer at a time. That is also a very common operation to do. Now, what I would like to say here is I forgot to add the bifocals. So what I would like to add here is a word of caution, because in general, there are a couple of drawbacks with intersections. First of all, they are typically very costly operations. They're very difficult to compute and it takes a lot of time. So if we abuse them, if we use them too extensively, our Grasshopper definitions, or in any other modeling environment, is the same pretty much. They might lag a lot. They may not be as optimal as we want to. So the using a lot of intersections typically results in performance issues in our algorithms taking a long time to compute. So just make sure that you only use intersections if you only strictly need to do, and if there's no other way around it. And similar, I would also like to say that sometimes, depending on the environment that you live in, Rhino, Grasshopper, and other modeling environments, some intersection operations may just simply fail, or may just not work as well as you expected. Sometimes intersection operations are buggy because we're still figuring out all these like nerves, madness, etc., etc. So sometimes it's not guaranteed that they will succeed. So just keep an eye. So in this case, Rhino and Grasshopper is actually pretty stable and much better now than in a few years back. I used to run into some problems here, but I don't think that's happening anymore. But in general, for the reasons that I just explained, because operations can be buggy and because operations can lead to performance issues, just try to only use intersections whenever you just don't have another way around it. And in general, and this is a general parametric modeling advice, if you will, in general, I find that many operations that are typically done with intersection methods could sometimes be done by simple generative methods. So sometimes we want to generate a shape and then like slice it, but if the shape is simple enough, we may actually find rules to, instead of finding the curves of the intersection by cutting the object, we may actually be able to generate manually, numerically, that geometry. So whenever you're going to use intersection operations, think it through and think it first if there are ways of generating that geometry manually as opposed to from an intersection operation, because that will typically lead to a lot of advantages down the road in your parametric modeling and in terms of stability. Well, without that, I actually think that I would like to make an example. I'll show you an example of a typical application of intersections in a parametric modeling workflow. So thank you very much and see you on the next video where I'm going to do a hands-on example on intersections. Bye-bye.